FSN Radio.
It's all about what's next.
Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports.
The Financial Survival Network.
It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz. Today's October 23rd, 2017. Well, is the world falling apart? Certainly in one respect, you could make that argument in terms of countries no longer being able to stay together and kind of falling apart at the seams, succession movements, things of that nature. Oh, and before we get started, email us kl@kerrylutz.com, Twitter feeds @KerryLutz, and with us now is John Rubino of dollarcollapse.com.
Hey, Kerry.
Morning.
These elections keep coming in which either the local version of Donald Trump gets elected or some region or group of regions decide they want more autonomy or complete freedom. You know, we saw it in Spain where Catalonia, the richest part of Spain, decided it wanted to be its own country. And Spain just intervened and basically took over Catalonia. You know, it's now kind of sort of martial law in that region. And Italy, some of their regions just voted here in the last few days for much greater autonomy, which is the first step in a breakup of Italy, which, by the way, wasn't even a country not so long ago. It was just a bunch of principalities that were unified into a country. But these guys all remember when they basically run their own show. And so it's easy to envision for them breaking off and becoming separate countries again, if you're a rich, especially northern Italian region. Austria just elected a 31-year-old version of Donald Trump. So we'll see what he does. You know, it's hard to know what a 31-year-old is going to do in any aspect of his life, because that's awfully unformed. You know, it's very young to be making big decisions. But still, the voters spoke and they want something very different. So we'll see what happens in Austria. And the Czech Republic just elected a billionaire who is billed as their version of Donald Trump.
Everybody's got one.
Everybody wants a Donald Trump. Yeah.
And except half of our country.
Yeah, except us. But he's very anti-immigrant, which is a big issue in Europe, because especially the smaller, more homogenous countries, you know, where everybody is pretty much Polish or Czech or whatever, a relatively small number of incoming immigrants from very different cultures is really noticeable for these guys, and they don't like it. So they're voting for people who are going to try to scale back the amount of immigration or close it off altogether, which is a direct threat to the policies of the EU. You know, they're based on open borders, and internally, at least. That was the selling point. Well, internally, we'll be like, Tennessee and Montana or something like that. You're allowed to move there back and forth if you're a member of the EU with no real border issues. But they've evolved since then to apply that policy to the outside world, really. They're letting in huge numbers of foreign immigrants that are perceived to be swamping local cultures by a lot of people in a lot of countries. And that's putting them under a lot of pressure right now, because you can't have coherent immigration policy and internal movement policy if you've got member states closing their borders. So that's what the EU is dealing with right now. And it doesn't seem to be ending anytime soon, because the number of immigrants coming in is still rising. And the elections that seem to be trending towards fringe candidates from the right winning or taking a big share are still coming. You know, there's still a lot of elections, as there always are in democracies, in the year ahead. And a lot of them are going to be disturbing from the point of view of the guys running the EU. So this is a recipe for chaos in the Eurozone, which is the second biggest currency block, or the block that controls and manages the second most important global currency. So it's potentially an interesting thing, and it has ramifications for the global financial markets going forward.
Oh, yes, it does. When that EU starts giving out, you know, what's going to happen to the dollar at that point, right? In all likelihood,
Well, yeah, okay. So you've got currency turmoil in the sense that, that countries are doing different things with their currencies or having problems that affect their currencies. At the same time, you've got the rise of cryptocurrencies, which are, it looks like, becoming a direct threat to the fiat currency world. You know, you've got not only Bitcoin and the thousand or so other cryptocurrencies soaring in aggregate value, which means, in effect, the global money supply is increasing at a rate that wasn't accounted for if you just look at the fiat currencies of the world. And at the same time, you've got some national governments looking at creating their own cryptocurrencies. So there was an interesting article that came out over the weekend about how the currency wars are morphing now from fiat currency versus fiat currency to state-run cryptocurrency versus private sector cryptocurrency. Mm-hmm. And that's an interesting wild card. You know, we've never seen anything like this happen before. But I think that potentially, at least, cryptocurrencies are a direct threat to fiat currencies, if for no other reason than that they're inflationary when you think about it. You know, if you buy a Bitcoin with dollars, and Bitcoin and dollars stay relatively stable in terms of their value, then that's not inflationary because you gave up one currency for another currency, but the aggregate purchasing power in the system hasn't changed. But if you buy a Bitcoin with a dollar and the value of the Bitcoin goes up by 1,000%, then that's a dramatic increase in purchasing power out there, which is inflationary, you know, and there seems to be no end in sight to the increase in the size of the cryptocurrency universe. And that's, in effect, a big increase in the global money supply. So we'll see how we deal with that. But again, it's a new factor that's never had to be dealt with before. And coming at a time when we're so highly leveraged that we're pretty fragile, you know, the global financial system can't handle a big shock just because there's so much debt out there. And that debt can do all kinds of crazy things when uncertainty spikes.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, you know, you add it all up and you've got a lot of uncertainty out there.
That we do. Lots and lots of uncertainty. So where's the solution here, John?
Oh, there's no solution to the amount of debt that we've taken on. There's only one kind of crisis or another.
That was a little bit of a rhetorical question. Okay. As you know.
Yeah, Carrie, we've been over this territory enough times where you know, we're talking about this stuff as interesting and fun to watch and stuff like that. But really, what it's in the context of a global financial system that is headed for some kind of a gigantic crisis. As we take on more and more debt and we leverage our big financial institutions to a greater and greater extent, and governments effectively go broke, but cover it over by printing a huge amount of new currency or whatever, you know, all this stuff is continuing to happen at an accelerating rate. So somewhere out there is this brick wall that the financial system hits and it all blows up. But it's interesting to chronicle the process as technology in the form of cryptocurrencies and politics in the form of all these disruptive elections throw wrenches into the system that haven't existed in previous financial crises. So it becomes harder and harder to predict with any kind of certainty what the details of the crises will be. You know, not that it was ever easy, but it used to be that you could look at the stock market and say, okay, you know, 26 times forward earnings, that's far enough, you know. Now we've got a crisis. And, you know, margin debt at 50% above any previous level. Okay, we've got a bear market coming our way. Well, you can't really do that as easily anymore because you've got all these other factors. You know, all the central banks of the world armed with unlimited printing presses and a willingness to buy equities or bonds or soon real estate, who knows, you know, and that changes things.
Yeah.
But not in a good way. It just means that maybe asset prices can go up further than we thought. But that's at the cost of greater and greater currency instability. Because if you buy up all the assets of the world by printing a lot of new currency, then you basically shifted the risk to the currency because oversupply will lead to a plunge in value at some point, which then filters back to all the asset markets and causes turmoil there, you know, and of course causes political turmoil along the way. So we basically just substituted a debt crisis, in effect, or substitute a currency crisis for a debt crisis by buying up all the debts of the world.
Which is much preferable, huh? Much more preferable. Which is worse? Which is worse? We had a banking problem, which we then let metastasize into a, you know, a currency crisis and a governing crisis, right?
Well, in the aftermath of the bursting of the housing bubble, mm-hmm. we basically had a banking crisis. You know, all the banks would have gone bust if we didn't step in and bail them out. And so we used our fiat currencies to bail out the private financial system. But now the problem is we've bid up the price of, for instance, government debt in order to save the banks to the point where government bonds don't yield much of anything, and in a lot of cases yield negative rates. And this is 8 years into a recovery. You know, normally economic expansions last about 6 years. So we're due for another downturn, just, you know, other things being equal, normal world, that kind of a scenario. Just the length of the recovery means that we've got a recession coming. Well, how do you manage your way out of a recession if you're a central bank when your government's bonds already have negative yields? And there's one theory that these government-run cryptocurrencies that governments are planning to introduce, apparently, that's the vehicle for allowing them to impose even more sharply negative interest rates going forward, because they'll have total control of the currency. And there won't be any cash in that market. So we won't be able to pull our cash out of the bank and in that way short circuit the central bank's attempt to lower interest rates below zero. So in a cryptocurrency world where the cryptocurrencies are run by the government, we can have extremely negative interest rates. And maybe that's their plan for getting us out of the next recession, which would just be so catastrophic, Gary. Oh, my God. You know, if we have a global policy of 2 or 3 or 4% negative interest rates, that is such uncharted territory and such a disaster for savers. You know, we're right.
What's a saver?
Advantaging,
endangered species is a saver.
You know, and a Keynesian economist would say, well, good, savings are a problem. You know, when you have too much savings, the economy doesn't grow. So let's just convince everybody to stop saving, and we'll generate wealth via governments issuing new and more debt in order to spend more and more money. And this is just a catastrophe. You know, historians will have a blast with this, but we have to live through it, you know. And I got to say, though, Carrie, all of these scenarios look great for gold, because remember, if they let it stay legal, you know, if they don't try to ban gold in a scenario where cryptocurrencies are the dominant form of transaction mechanism out there and cryptocurrencies yield negative rates. Well, gold costs you a percentage point a year to store somewhere, which is not great when treasury bonds yield 6%. You know, it's a big difference in cash flow there. But if treasury bonds yield negative 3% and gold still costs 1% to store, all of a sudden gold is the winner in the race for cash flow, you know, because it's less negative while it holds its value better than currencies that are run by governments historically. So all of a sudden gold looks pretty good. And okay. So that might be the next battle out there for central banks. How do you maintain negative interest rates when everybody's putting their money in real assets like gold and silver and farmland? You know, you basically ignite a hyperinflation by trying to push rates down so far beyond the zero bound that you create a mass migration of capital out of financial assets. That might be their next problem. And it'll be interesting to see what kind of authoritarian policies they come up with to stop that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, what can they do? The capital negative controls, interest rates. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, in the Depression, they made gold ownership illegal. And that allowed them to dramatically increase the money supply. Well, this time around, you know, they'll try something crazy, because they've been trying crazy stuff up till now. And the list of crazy things that governments could do, that's a long list. So it's not clear now what they're going to do, but it could involve some kind of really extreme capital control on the movement of capital in and out of the U.S. It could be some kind of a takeover of the private investment accounts that we have out there. You know, if you've got a bunch of money in your 401k or your IRA and it's not being taxed, that's this big pot of gold that the government is eyeing and probably will want to take at some point in order to finance itself. So you might see a mass conversion of stock portfolios in IRAs and 401ks into government bond portfolios. which would be a disaster, you know, because then once you're locked into government bonds, they can devalue the currency to their heart's content. You know, you can't move your money into a real asset if real assets are all owned by the government. So, I don't know, Kerry. It's a terrifying prospect. But I think one thing you would have to say about it is that volatility will go up from here, you know, which is right now the biggest measure of volatility in the stock market is at an all-time low, meaning that the markets expect nice, steady increases in equity prices and by implication in other financial asset prices going forward. And that's the least likely outcome of all the stuff we're talking about here. You know, volatility has got to spike when things really get crazy. So that might be and by the way, there are a lot of new hedge funds coming along designed to short volatility, or I'm sorry, to go long volatility. In other words, they're going to bet on turmoil in the financial markets directly, you know, not even bothering with which financial asset do you want to own. They're just going to bet that financial assets bounce around really dramatically from here. And I think that's probably a pretty good bet going forward.
I think you're right, John. I think you're right. Well, it's a crazy world out there, and it would be great if somebody knew what they were doing, but evidently nobody seems to have been able to figure it out, have they?
No. And it's because this is such uncharted territory. We've never been in this position before where valuations of financial assets don't seem to matter because governments are buying them at market. You know, they're just going in and buying stuff in order to manipulate the markets without really paying attention to what they're buying or what price they're paying. And that's making it impossible to use history as a guide, which is why so many big hedge funds are folding. You know, you're seeing hedge funds that have been around for 30 years and been consistently profitable and usually on the right side of big moves, find themselves on the wrong side of a lot of relationships that used to work. You know, when their black box trading model doesn't work anymore because governments are distorting market relationships and the hedge funds have to fold, that's a sign that things have really changed. And it's a sign that today's world probably can't continue for much longer, because in the end, fundamentals do matter. It's just a question of which fundamental has to blow up in order to bring back historical balances. And I think we're making it the currency market now. You know, we're choosing to sacrifice the value of our fiat currencies in order to stabilize other asset classes. And that, you know, that can't last very long. If currencies become unstable, then everything else is unstable too.
Yeah, that's right. When currencies become unstable, that's it. So if the nominal price of an asset goes up in dollars, but those dollars are, you know, who knows what they're really worth, that really messes up the entire economy, makes it impossible to plan and to run your business, whether you're a small business or a big business. What are you supposed to do?
Well, that's how capitalism breaks down in inflationary periods, because if you're going to commit your capital to, say, building a factory, you need some sense of what the cash flow that factory is going to generate will be worth a decade from now or two decades from now, you know, because you've got a long-term payback period there. And as things get less and less stable, it becomes harder and harder to predict what those cash flows will be like. So you're less and less likely to build that factory. And, you know, this is straight out of Ayn Rand, where capital goes on strike in a system where government is becoming more and more powerful and more intrusive and disruptive. You know, the creative class basically just stops creating. And you could make the case that we're deeply into that point already, because productivity is down and a lot of good asset allocation isn't happening, and a lot of bad asset, you know, malinvestment is happening out there. So it's possible that historians will date the beginning of that process sometime in our past, you know, let's say 2000 or something, when the tech stock bubble burst and we really should have had the financial crisis that reset the system. But we decided to avoid that by pushing interest rates down to insanely low levels and creating huge amounts of new currency and guaranteeing every piece of debt in the world or buying it out.
Gotten
right.
Good at that.
Yeah. And that's the point. When we decided to make that our policy going forward, that's when things really changed. That's when we departed from historical norms. And because we've been able to manage that departure for such a long time at the cost of even bigger imbalances building up, when the reckoning comes, it'll be commensurately bigger. You know, the crisis will be so vast compared to what it would have been if we'd just had a serious global recession in 2000 and then changed our policies to prevent that from happening by deleveraging. You know, if we'd done that, which is would have been the logical thing to do at the time, then we'd be in way better shape now than we are. But we didn't. We did exactly the wrong thing in order to avoid short-term consequences of our mismanagement. And we magnified the problem. So here we are. You know, something big is coming.
Here we are. Yep, something's coming. We'll know when it gets here, that's for sure. Anyways, John, we will catch up with you next week. Same time, same place. FinancialSurvivalNetwork.com. Sign up for the newsletter. John's site, of course, is DollarCollapse.com. And don't forget about his newsletter as well. And the Twitter feed is at Carrie Lutz. The Facebook page is Financial Survival Network. John, we'll catch you next week.
Great, Carrie. Take care.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to FinancialSurvivalNetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next. FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to FinancialSurvivalNetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Carrie Lutz. Today's October 23rd, 2017. Well, is the world falling apart? Certainly in one respect, you could make that argument in terms of countries no longer being able to stay together and kind of falling apart at the seams, succession movements, things of that nature. Oh, and before we get started, email us kl@carrielutz.com, Twitter feeds at Carrie Lutz, and with us now is John Rubino of DollarCollapse.com.
Hey, Carrie.
Morning.
These elections keep coming in which either the local version of Donald Trump gets elected or some region or group of regions decide they want more autonomy or complete freedom. You know, we saw it in Spain where Catalonia, the richest part of Spain, decided it wanted to be its own country. And Spain just intervened and basically took over Catalonia. You know, it's now kind of sort of martial law in that region. And Italy, some of their regions just voted here in the last few days for much greater autonomy, which is the first step in a breakup of Italy, which, by the way, wasn't even a country not so long ago. It was just a bunch of principalities that were unified into a country. But these guys all remember when they basically run their own show. And so it's easy to envision for them breaking off and becoming separate countries again, if you're a rich, especially northern Italian region. Austria just elected a 31-year-old version of Donald Trump. So we'll see what he does. You know, it's hard to know what a 31-year-old is going to do in any aspect of his life, because that's awfully unformed. You know, it's very young to be making big decisions. But still, the voters spoke and they want something very different. So we'll see what happens in Austria. And the Czech Republic just elected a billionaire who is billed as their version of Donald Trump.
Everybody's got one.
Everybody wants a Donald Trump now. Yeah.
And except half of our country.
Yeah, except us. But he's very anti-immigrant, which is a big issue in Europe, because especially the smaller, more homogenous countries, you know, where everybody is pretty much Polish or Czech or whatever, a relatively small number of incoming immigrants from very different cultures is really noticeable for these guys, and they don't like it. So they're voting for people who are going to try to scale back the amount of immigration or close it off currencies, if for no other reason than that they're inflationary when you think about it. You know, if you buy a Bitcoin with dollars and Bitcoin and dollars stay relatively stable in terms of their value, then that's not inflationary, because you gave up one currency for another currency, but the aggregate purchasing power in the system hasn't changed. But if you buy a Bitcoin with a dollar, dollar and the value of the Bitcoin goes up by 1,000%, then that's a dramatic increase in purchasing power out there, which is inflationary, you know, and there seems to be no end in sight to the increase in the size of the cryptocurrency universe. And that's in effect a big increase in the global money supply. So we'll see how we deal with that. But again, it's a new factor that's never had to be dealt with before. And coming at a time when we're so highly leveraged that we're pretty fragile, you know, the global financial system can't handle a big shock just because there's so much debt out there. And that debt can do all kinds of crazy things when uncertainty spikes.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, you know, you add it all up and you've got a lot of uncertainty out there.
That we do. Lots and lots of uncertainty. So where's the solution here, John?
Oh, there's no solution to the amount of debt that we've taken on. There's only one kind of crisis or another.
That was a little bit of a rhetorical question. Okay. As you know.
Yeah, Kerry, we've been over this territory altogether, which is a direct threat to the policies of the EU. You know, they're based on open borders. And internally, at least, that was the selling point. Well, internally, we'll be like, you know, Tennessee and Montana or something like that. You're allowed to move there back and forth if you're a member of the EU with no real border issues. But they've evolved since then to apply that policy to the outside world, really. They're letting in huge numbers of foreign immigrants that are perceived to be swamping local cultures by a lot of people in a lot of countries. And that's putting them under a lot of pressure right now, because you can't have coherent immigration policy and internal movement policy if you've got member states closing their borders. So that's what the EU is dealing with right now. And it doesn't seem to be ending anytime soon, because the number of immigrants coming in is still rising. And the elections that seem to be trending towards fringe candidates from the right winning or taking a big share are still coming. You know, there's still a lot of elections, as there always are in democracies, in the year ahead. And a lot of them are going to be disturbing from the point of view of the guys running the EU. So this is a recipe for chaos in the Eurozone, which is the second biggest currency block, or the block that controls and manages the second most important global currency. So it's potentially an interesting thing, and it has ramifications for the global financial markets going forward.
Oh, yes, it does. When that EU starts giving out, you know, what's going to happen to the dollar at that point, right? In all likelihood?
Well, yeah, so you've got currency turmoil in the sense that, that countries are doing different things with their currencies or having problems that affect their currencies. At the same time, you've got the rise of cryptocurrencies, which are, it looks like, becoming a direct threat to the fiat currency world. You know, you've got not only Bitcoin and the thousand or so other cryptocurrencies soaring in aggregate value, which means, in effect, the global money supply is increasing at a rate that wasn't accounted for if you just look at the fiat currencies of the world. And at the same time, you've got some national governments looking at creating their own cryptocurrencies. So there was an interesting article that came out over the weekend about how the currency wars are morphing now from fiat currency versus fiat currency to state-run cryptocurrency versus private sector cryptocurrency. Mm-hmm. And that's an interesting wild card. You know, we've never seen anything like this happen before. But I think that potentially, at least, cryptocurrencies are a direct threat to fiat